All right, guys, we thank you all for coming out here and supporting the family through their loss, remembering Mabel here. We're going to start out with some songs. The two songs we're going to sing, we're going to sing three songs, but the two songs we're going to sing were some of Mabel's favorites, so we'd like to bless you with those. And if you want to sing along, we don't care how you sound. Be wholehearted and, you know, be thankful for Mabel and for the gift she was to all of you here. And, you know, Mabel was a believer, so it's bittersweet. She's with the Lord now, and we're comforted by where she's at. So please join me in prayer as we open with prayer here. Father, we do thank you for this precious family. Thank you for my friends here. And we just lift up this family this morning, this afternoon, and ask that you'd comfort them, Lord, through their loss. We thank you for the comfort you give us and the assurance of faith you grant to us that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And Father, we ask that you'd help this family through their loss, help them through their mourning, and may you, as you have promised in your word, comfort those who are mourning. And you said we're blessed in that. So bless this whole time we have together as we remember Mabel, and may this be comforting, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Second one we'd like to sing is The Old Rugged Cross. Again, if you know it, feel free to sing along. guys have one more they'd like to share with you that was written for a believer that was dying of cancer. And it was written by Daniel, and hopefully the words will minister to you this morning or this afternoon.
Not nervous. Doesn't ever happen. So like you said, I wrote this song for a believer that was passing away, a friend of mine. And like I said, we're hoping that it would minister to you guys too. Thank you.
Place your trust in Christ. Walk this narrow road, you'll see our Savior's face. When you reach your journey's end, place your trust in Christ. Ooh. Ooh. Amen.
The shortest verse in the Bible is Jesus wept, and that was at the death of his friend Lazarus. We might ask the question, why would he weep knowing he was going to raise him from the dead? And I would say he was feeling the pain of the people that were present and thinking of how many lives, you know, death has taken from us, an enemy of human beings, an enemy of God. And Jesus Christ came to conquer death. And of course, we might ask ourselves the question, why death still exists? Well, it's not time yet. But one of these days, he's going to return and wipe it out completely from all of humanity. But he's given us a hope. We have an empty tomb with the assurance that, you know, this part of Mabel here will be resurrected and raised from the dead. But as we pointed out, Dave stole my scripture today, 2 Corinthians 5. I love my brother, and I love TJ and Annie and Katie, and I had no idea that my mother-in-law worked with your mom at the safe house. So it's a small world, and just love you too. But we have this hope, and right now it's a sad thing, but we have the comfort of knowing where Mabel is at. She's with the Lord. She had faith in Jesus Christ, and I wasn't there at her passing, but Terry was telling me at her passing there was a peace present, and the Lord's presence was there. Now, I'd like to read out the obituary. The obituary is a beautiful thing because it reminds us of the connections that people have historically and the connections in this room this morning or this afternoon. And some people also discover that they were family members and didn't even know it, perhaps. You know, that does happen sometimes. But let's read this out. It's beautifully written, as always. It says, Mabel Maxine Brown, 78. Passed away Friday, November the 22nd, 2019, at a home in Rock Springs, Wyoming, surrounded by her loving family. She was a resident of Rock Springs for 60 years and is a former resident of Missouri. Mrs. Brown was born on March the 1st, 1941, in Mountain View, Missouri, the daughter of Ira Brooks and Bessie Margaret McClellan. She attended schools in Mountain View, Missouri, and was a 1957 graduate of Mountain View High School. Mabel married Gerald B. Brown Sr. on November the 13th, 1957, in St. Louis, Missouri. Mrs. Brown was a professional mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother. She was a member of the Fraternal Order of Eagles Auxiliary, Area 151. Mrs. Brown enjoyed spending time with her children and grandchildren, sewing, gambling, listening to music, and camping. Her survivors include her husband, three daughters, Terry Doak and husband Tim of Rock Springs, Wyoming, Debbie O'Neill, and husband David of Kingman, Arizona, Janet Cunningham, and husband Tom of Rock Springs, Wyoming, daughter-in-law Laurie Brown of Rock Springs, Wyoming, two brothers, John Brooks of Mountain View, Missouri, Kenny Brooks of Somersville, Missouri, one sister, Eva Crawford of Star City, Indiana, 7 grandchildren, David Trujillo and wife Katie, Shannon Shore and husband Brad, Trey Doak and wife Emily, Buck Brown and wife Bonnie, Jenny Reed and husband Stephen, Julie Cunningham, TJ Cunningham and wife Annie, 12 great-grandchildren, as well as several nieces and nephews. She was preceded in death by her parents, 3 brothers, 2 sisters, and 1 son, Gerald Brown Jr. And so that's quite a history there. As I met with the family, I discovered that Mabel was quite a character. I never got to meet her myself, but I know that Dave described her as Willy Wonka candy, hard on the outside but all soft within. And I believe her correction, when she corrected you, she was described as a heat-seeking missile, was how it was described. And that's how the grandkids described it. I'm just reiterating. They were on the receiving end of some of that, I know, but they know that their grandma loved them, and they had a wonderful relationship. All the family described her as the strongest woman they've ever known. She spent a lot of time with the grandkids, loved her grandkids, and one of the stories go, when the grandkids would spend the night and the kids would come to pick them up, she would have them fake being asleep and say, "They're sleeping, come back tomorrow." I wish I would have met her, but one day I believe I will. By the grace of God, I'll make it there too. But just hearing you guys describe her, I know Terry referred to her mom as her best friend. She said she could tell her mom anything. And I think as parents, we could learn from that, right? That we want to be the kind of parents that our kids could tell us anything. And they know we're not going to, beat them up over it, but be there. And Mabel was a very hard worker. Didn't always have it easy, but didn't complain. I know Terry in particular reminded me of what a great example she was, that she didn't have it easy, but she didn't complain, and was strong. When someone passes, they leave a hole and a void in our life, and a hole and a void that will not be filled. There's no way about that. That's a reality check. That's why we grieve. I grieve for my friends who I see grieving, that though I did not know Mabel personally, I grieve for my brother Dave, and I grieve for my brother TJ, and I grieve for Terry here and the rest of the family. But she lives on, even here, in a sense, through our memories, through what she passed on. Here's an example. She'll live on through her biscuits and gravy. There's a thought. Every time you make biscuits and gravy, you'll think of Grandma, and her touch is upon it. Now, hopefully, she lives on through the cobbler. Anyone get the recipe? No? Yeah? Okay, good. And also through the quilts that she made. She handed out many quilts to the family, and those quilts will also remind you. But more importantly, she left memories here. She planted seeds here that will not be erased. But more importantly, she's with the Lord forever. And now she's free. And I hear she was sick for, 5 years she was sick? And, to leave this body behind, there comes a point that sometimes a person's body runs out of mileage. You can't do it anymore. But the Bible tells us that though the outward man is perishing, the inward man is being renewed day by day. And though she's left this body behind, she's now, her spirit is free. She's not in pain anymore. She's not hurting anymore. And she's not old anymore. That's another thing that gets erased when someone goes to be with Jesus, is age. You're free. You're gone. Just before I bring Dave up, I'd just like to reiterate a couple of passages to you. 1 Corinthians 13:12. One reason why we grieve, even though we have great faith, is that we only know in part. We only see in part. We're on this side of heaven. She's entered into glory. And we read in the Bible what heaven is like, and we read about the reality of Jesus Christ, and we are comforted by that. But because we only know in part and we only see in part, we also grieve as well. So our current condition is described here in 1 Corinthians 13:12. It says, for now, this is our current state, we see in the mirror dimly. We don't see everything clearly, but then face to face. You see, Mabel only saw dimly as we do, but now she sees the Lord face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know, just as I have also been fully known. And I think when we go to be with the Lord as believers, that we'll look back and we'll realize, wow, the Lord was there all along. Perhaps you've heard the poem, The Footprints in the Sand, how that he had a dream and he got to look back on his life and he saw two sets of footprints. And there was a certain part during the most troubled aspects of that person's life. He only saw one set. And he was puzzled and asked the Lord, Lord, why weren't you with me in those difficult times? And you know the answer. The Lord turned around and said, that's when I carried you. The Lord is always there with us through the hard times. And that time of her passing was also in God's hands. The Bible says that there's a book of life, and that each person's life is written in that book. And every day that we live is in that book, including our last day. And he's in charge of when that last day is. And the humbling thing is, none of us know when that last day is, except him. One more passage, just to encourage you and bring comfort to your heart. John 14, here, I'd like to read to you. It's a wonderful passage, and I want to encourage you by the words of our Lord here in this passage. If these words were uttered by just any old individual, we might think, yeah, right. But these words were uttered by Jesus himself. And he said this, he says, let not your heart be troubled. Our hearts are troubled right now. But then he goes on to say, you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions or many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Even believers, sometimes we're scared to death of dying. But I believe when death does occur, God gives us the grace to go through that. And as soon as we leave this body, I believe the Lord is there to meet us. And he's there to show us that we're in no surprise. He's been preparing a place for us all along. So please, in the midst of our grief, be comforted by the thought of where Mabel is now at with the Lord. My friend Dave, would you come out please and share?
Small, huh?
Yeah, they're small.
Yeah. Love you too, buddy. Can you hear me? Just on? Hello?
Yeah, you're Well, we want to thank everybody for coming out today. And I'm going to start in 2 Corinthians 5. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan earnestly, desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so, that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that had wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto this earnest of the Spirit. Therefore we always are confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. And we are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore we labor, that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as through God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Love. The word love can mean many different things. An extreme fondness of a certain food, place, or person. And sometimes there is a varying degree of love we either feel from or give to a person. But almost always, though, this love can have a small dose of selfishness in it. But then there is a greater love that some possess that we call unconditional love. A love so big and selfless that it is only meant to radiate on someone to show the value their lives have in ours. Tenacity. When you talk about tenacity and the will to survive, one can only look to God's chosen people, the Jewish nation. Time and again, they have been beat down only to rise from the ashes. We often heard growing up, if you get bucked off that horse, jump right back on. Now some can and will, and some will run away and cry with a sore butt. Now these two attributes we have looked at are very admirable character qualities, and I think all of us would at least want to excel at them. But sadly, not everyone will. But throughout the ripple of time, there have been people who have shown both qualities to be very high in their arsenal of characteristics to arm them for this battle we call life. And I, for one, think these people should be heralded and celebrated. And today, folks, we have the great honor and privilege to do just that. Mabel Brown was one such person. I can personally attest that one would be hard-pressed to find a woman who exonerated these qualities more than my grandmother. Time and again throughout my life, I witnessed a woman who could be as fierce as a honey badger, but as gentle as a lamb. Another attribute that is part of the extraordinary package of Mabel Brown is her motherly love. And from that great and awesome love funneled right down into her daughters and my mother, Terry. And an extension of my grandmother, I was raised by a woman who, being a mother to me, is as great a gift to her as her very salvation. If the world ever invented a picture dictionary, the two faces you would see champion for unconditional motherly love would be Mabel and Terry. My grandmother was a loving wife. She was blessed to have shared 62 years of marriage with her husband, my grandfather, Jerry Brown. Now they could bicker and hiss at each other like two old alley cats, but the unmistakable bond of eternal binding love always showed in the twinkling of their eyes when gazing at each other in admiration. What a testament to Mabel it was to see how proud Jerry is to have called her his wife. No, I've never seen my grandpa smile like the way he does when he sees her. She counts her grandkids as absolute treasures and her great-grandkids as grander yet. Loyal as a mother bear when it came to family and honest as a preacher when it came to friends. She was an absolute gem to all who got to experience life with her. So today, as she's enjoying her time in heaven, let's take this day to enjoy and celebrate the love and memory of her, Mabel Brown.
We're just going to show a video presentation here of some wonderful memories, wonderful connections, and I think it's about 10, 15 minutes long, so just take this time to meditate.
Looking back on the memory of the dance we shared beneath the stars above. For a moment, all the world was right. How could I have known that you'd ever say goodbye? And now I'm glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way it all would go. Our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance. Holding you, I held everything for a moment. Wasn't I the king? But if I'd only known how the king would fall, hey, who's to say? You know I might have changed it all. And I'm glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way it all would go. Our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance. It's my life, it's better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance. Mercy. treat you, I'll treat you right. Come with me, baby, be mine tonight. Pretty woman, don't walk on by. Pretty woman, don't make me cry. Pretty woman, don't walk away. Hey, okay, that's the way it must be. Okay, I guess I'll go on home. It's late, there'll be tomorrow night. But wait, what do I see?
The dreams we left behind, I'll be glad, 'cause I was blessed to get to have you in my life. When I look back on these days, I'll look and see your face. You were right there for me. Place for you for all my life. I'll keep is not where it ends. I will care.